privilege to be here with him as in the chair. Much pleased to see all of you. You today don't may not realize it, but you represent a new social revolution in our country. It's the beginning of a social revolution. The empowerment of the educated class, which empowerment was systematically over the last 60 years denied. The empowerment of the educated class you can see in the United States, you can see it in Europe, you can see it in Japan, even in China. Even though it's a communist country, the people who wield the power are educated people. In India, we have lost that out after the freedom struggle had empowered the educated class. People sacrificed their careers, came into politics to fight for independence. And they were all eminent people. Over the years, it just slowly petered out. And today, we see a revival, thanks to this new media called the internet. And it's a value system which everybody, even today in India, subscribes to. And that is why people who have not passed fifth class claim that they were educated in the University of Cambridge. Because that's the what you want to be known as, an educated person. So I think we will build this movement and take it to an All India level. And it is from that point of view that we are organizing this conference. While tweeting, I find all of you have given me material which I couldn't get anywhere else. I just put out one tweet once saying, does anybody know how many companies Karthi Chidambaram owns? And within 3 days, I got a reply giving all the companies in which he was there. So yeah, it's a highly knowledgeable, educated crowd. And the country can progress enormously if the right policies are followed. We were told that the growth rate of India was the Hindu growth rate of 3.5%, where actually it was the communist rate of growth because we were following the Soviet model. But we will never be able to grow faster than that. But one change in policy to economic reform made us go right up to 9.5% per year. So with the same change in policy, if we can bring it about, we can ensure a growth rate for at least the next 20 years of in excess of 12%. And it's not enough to be educated. You have to have a backbone. I mentioned this in all my speeches. It's not enough to have numbers. You can have 1,000 goats at one place, and one tiger comes, all the goats will run away. Majority is with the goats, and the tiger is a singleton. But the mental framework of the goat is fear, and he runs away. It's not enough to be strong, because you can go to a circus and see well-fed lions in a cage, and a thin, wiry ringmaster will walk in, close the gate, and then order the lions to climb up a bench. They'll all climb up. He'll order them to open their mouth. He'll put his head inside. And these lions will not do anything when they can rip him apart into pieces. This is all because of the mindset. That's how the lion has been brought up from when it was a cub. And in lion, in Sanskrit, we call it Singh. So Manmohan Singh is a circus lion. It's no use giving him the Prime Minister's position. The only reason I want him to stay is because the one that's going to come after this is going to be worse. So therefore, let me begin by saying, today the whole idea of the conference is the mindset. What kind of a mind should you have to make India great once again? I've been out to speak on current affairs and politics. Politics is like fire. In other words, fire has no independent existence. It needs either a piece of log, or it needs rubber, it needs petrol, kerosene, you know, it needs some medium in which it has to exist or burn. Sometimes the medium doesn't make it burn very much. Sometimes you put ghee in fire, it will burn much more. So the same way politics, there's no independent existence for politics. Politics is in economics, it's in national security, it's in finance, it's in all the areas, in academia, everywhere there's politics. It depends on the medium. But essentially, the art of politics is to bring all these mediums and choose your medium in such a way that you get the right to rule and bring and implement the right policies. And that's why politics is so important. You may be a member of a political party or not a member, but politics is not necessarily being a member of a political party and contesting elections. You can assist a political party without being its member. In America, we find professors will take leave and go to the headquarters of a political party and help them to lick stamps and stick them and post letters. This kind of thing they would do. Or mobilize voters, hold parties for visiting candidates, that kind of thing. That kind of participation in politics, intelligent people of our society must undertake. Now, politics naturally also evokes vote banks. Vote banks mean subnational identities like caste, region, language. I call them sub-identity because we all have one identity. The Indian identity, which I call as the Hindustan identity. And for reasons I will explain a little later. Then, of course, we have religion, we have law and order, we have economic issues, international issues, all that. So all these things are part and parcels of various dimensions of politics. Now, in every election there has been one issue of politics. Let's not go too far back. 1971, Garibi Hatao, an economic object. In comes another giant intellectual called Guru Murthy. He's also part of the lion crowd, not the goat crowd. And not in the circus. So, 1971, the overriding issue. This was before the Bangladesh war, not after. After was the assembly elections. But in 1971, March 71, the issue was Garibi Hatao, single issue, economics. 77, the single issue was democracy, emergency. 1980, Mrs. Gandhi came back on the one single issue, stability, because the Janata Party broke up. 1984, the issue was emotional sympathy for what happened to Mrs. Gandhi and a feeling of nationalism. The whole nation voted as one in the highest ever any party has ever won, Lok Sabha, 415 seats, Rajiv Gandhi won on that. 1989, the single issue was corruption, Bofors, in which Mr. Gurumurthy played a big part. ahead, yes, in 86. Yeah, that opened the issue. So will you go to jail again if you like for us? So he was relentless crusader, wrote articles, and changed the whole climate. And 1989 was fought on the issue of corruption. 1991 was the issue not only of Rajiv Gandhi's assassination, but the undercurrent of economic reform because we had an economic crisis. 1996 became the opposite. The Congress Party discredited Narasimha Rao so much that there was an anti-reform movement, an anti-WTO movement. And that brought in the left front and the so-called United Front to power. 1998 was a search for alternative. The NDA came to power for the first time. 2004, in my opinion, was a revolt of the workers of different parties. 2009 was pure victory of the electronic voting machine. And I've almost won 95% of the case in the Supreme Court. If I win 100% on 23rd January, then the next election will not be because of EVM magic, but it will be the issue again of corruption, single, plus perhaps a subsidiary issue of national unity, which is also under threat. Now, why this national unity question is coming up? One is what people are witnessing is happening in Northeast. People from Bangladesh are streaming into India, and district religious composition is changing. Many districts which were minority proportion for Muslims now have become majority. And I was recently in Dibrugarh, and they were all expressing apprehension. This issue is important because it is an observable phenomenon that where Muslims are in majority, there is no democracy, and there is also no protection for non-Muslim minorities. We see this in Kashmir. 5 lakh Hindus have been driven out of Kashmir still since 1989, still in refugee camps, most of them, miserable conditions. They are not able to do anything. Assam, we saw this recently in Bodoland. In Kerala, go to Malappuram. No Hindu can sell his property to another Hindu. That is the law there. You can't address public meetings in Malappuram. In the last 24 years, the first public meeting addressed by Hindu was myself. And that is because the local Muslim municipality, controlled Muslim municipality, said, otherwise this man will go to court and create problems for us, so let him address and go away. So they allowed me to address. But you can see Sharia courts in Kerala today. The Hindu percentage is 53-54%. New census might show them in minority, I can't say, but that is, it is rapidly changing. So you find that. You find it in Meerut, you find it in Azamgarh, Ghazipur. So, wherever, whether it's a state, country, or district, or even town panchayat. You want to see a town panchayat? Go to Vellore, and nearby is a place called Mel Visharam. There, 75% Muslim. They held election, swept the town panchayat. 25% of the Hindus for 20 years have been denied all amenities on only one ground, namely that you will not get anything unless you become a Muslim. And they resisted it. They were scheduled castes. They resisted it for 20 years and finally they found me through the Vishwanatha Parishad. And then I went to court. Court wouldn't believe it till I produced the records. Then finally they issued direction to the governor that either fix it or we will break this this town panchayat into two village panchayats, one Muslim and one Hindu. On that threat, this was sorted out. But then I found out there are 40 other town panchayats in Tamil Nadu. Even though the whole of Tamil Nadu, the Muslim population is only 5%, there are 40 town panchayats, this is going on, Tondi, near Rameshwaram, etc. So, I don't blame the Muslims for it, their mind is clear. It is we educated people whose mind is not clear. So, I'm trying to clear your mind that if they are in majority, no democracy. Tell me which country in the world, the Muslim majority, the nearest thing that came was Turkey, and look what's happening in Turkey. So, this factor makes it important that for this country, if you want democracy, please ensure that the Hindu majority is retained not only at the national level, the state level, but in the district level, in the town level, every level. And if one third of Bangladesh comes into India, look at the perspective. Why was Pakistan created? Because Jinnah said, and the British accepted, and the Congress Party accepted, that Muslims cannot live under Hindus. They cannot live with Hindus too. We are a separate nation. So those Muslims who felt that yes, we cannot live with Hindus, for them we partitioned India, cut a part of India out to make it into Pakistan, which later became Pakistan and Bangladesh. Now one third of Muslims who didn't want to live with India, with Hindus, have come back to live with Hindus. So what should we do? We should tell Bangladesh, please give us one third of your territory. Because that territory is really India. It's our territory which we gave away. But we gave it away on a condition. Don't meet that condition, then you must modify the condition. But for that you need a different kind of government with a mindset. And that is what I am trying to prepare you today. Both today, in the morning and the afternoon talk, I'm focusing only on this mindset. You should be free from all kinds of inferiority complexes, all the wrong notions that have been fed into your mind. You should think of India, yourself as an Indian, who's the inheritor of a magnificent civilization that has not broken yet. Greece broke, Egypt broke, Mesopotamia broke, Babylon broke, Iran broke, but not India. In fact, I had a story, a Saudi Arabian student in Harvard who once asked me, can you explain how India is still 83% Hindu? So I said, why are you asking this question? He said, no, we are studying this problem. Yeah. And he says, see, Iran was a Zoroastrian country. Powerful Zoroastrian country. We conquered it. Within 15 years, we made it 100% Muslim. Neighbor Babylon, Mesopotamia, which is now Iraq, in 17 years, we made them 100% Muslim. Egypt, in 21 years, we made them 100% Muslim. Europe, the Christians made Europe in 50 years 100% Christian. But you had 800 years rule of Muslims and 200 years rule of Christians, and yet you are 83%. What is the secret? The secret is Vijayanagaram Empire, Rana Pratap, Shivaji, Rani Jhansi, Guru Gobind Singh, and later on even Subhash Chandra Bose. We had fighters, or Kattabomman in Tamil Nadu, Rani Bennur, Rani Chennamma in Karnataka, the Andhra dynasties, the great Chalukyas of Gujarat, till they were betrayed. So all these, if you study history in its proper thing, Indians never gave up fighting. They fought. We had rules which were little out of date. One rule was that we will not start the fighting till the sun rises. And we will go back to our tent when the sun sets. So if you are attacked at night, what will you do? That's what Gauri did in the end, finally. He understood, finally attacked you at 3 a.m. in the morning. Then you will not fight in population centers, you will not fight in agricultural fields, you will fight in open maidan like Kurukshetra. Or when Ravan had to fight Rama, he came out of his palace, in his fort. He didn't say, come inside my fort and fight me. Like most in Britain, British history shows that they did. So he came out of maidan and fought. These people entered population centers, ruined your crops, all that. They played by different rules. And then finally we had a rule that if after losing you say, I'm sorry, you give him back everything and say, go back now. Then Mohammad Ghori went back how many times? 16 times. That was foolishness. He should not have, Prithviraj Chauhan shouldn't have forgiven him more than once. And today for terrorists, you should not even give them one chance. Total zero tolerance. So this was the rules which changed. The first person who changed this, all these rules, was Shivaji. That's why he was victorious. Those who played by the rules suffered, but we didn't give up the fight. So I will begin by saying to you that when we are discussing what to do about current affairs, please remember your glorious history. We invented mathematics, we invented science, rocketry also. Now the Americans openly admit, George Gamow, Wernher von Braun, they've written books to say the people who invented rockets, not the Chinese but the Indians. The concept of a solid propellant was invented by Indians, which then the British copied. We are not two countries, Aryans and Dravidians. The word Aryan is not there. Arya is there, means gentleman. In Tamil it is, we say Aya. In the north, in Sanskrit we say Arya. Dravida is a word not invented by E.V. Ramaswamy Naikar. It was invented by Shankaracharya, who said that Dravida means South India, Thra and Vid, Sandhi of two words. And he told this to Mandana Mishra when he went to debate him on whether Hinduism should prevail or Uttaramahimsa school should prevail. And he won that debate. So, we are one people, and I can prove it now by DNA studies also. All has been published. I even had lunch with Raj Thackeray once. I showed it to him that his DNA and the UP taxi driver's DNA is the same. He said, how did you get my DNA? I said, you have a friend who goes to the same hairdresser as you do, and after your last haircut, he gave me a sample of your hair. And you can test DNA by that. So, all our DNA is same. Hindu, Muslim, Brahmin, Kshatriya, scheduled caste, all our DNA is the same, no difference. But all these differences have ossified over a period of time. Varna became birth-based, and therefore all this got. So much of our current affairs is vitiated by the wrong notions which have been fed into your brain. Nobody wants to debate me in any debate. I asked Romila Thapar, come with a debate now. I won't come with you. I said, why? He said, you are not a gentleman. What does that mean? Does it mean I have to say, you are right on the whole, but on this one point you are not right. She's completely wholesale wrong. So how can I say she is right in parts? So, therefore, we need therefore to know our true history. Valiant attempts are being made. Rajiv Malhotra in America is trying his level best, but ultimately you need a government which does it. And we have to mobilize our public for a new order, not political order, democracy will remain, but a new order in which ideas triumph over baser instincts. Now, I come to the question of what are the main issues of today's current affairs. You tell me when I run out of time. I know you will anyway, but I thought I let the request come from you. I know. I'm running over here. Now, what are the issues? First is corruption. Overriding issue in the country, I have seen from traveling the length and breadth of India. Corruption is an issue where for the first time people feel we will sink or swim, depending on what we do on corruption. But they have this thing, who will remove corruption? Can corruption be removed? Of course can be removed. The dimension of corruption, I'm sure the two great thinkers are here. They will tell you how much is abroad, how much is floating around the country. Let me tell you, every problem in India today can be traced to corruption. Inflation, of course, corruption. Because the black money goes to the wholesale market and they buy up from the farmers. They pay them in cash. Farmers only accept cash. They don't accept checks. And cash is in black. And you give it to farmers, buy it, store it, create an artificial a shortage, and prices go up, sell it up there, prices come down. That's why if you look at the price curve of the last 2 years, you'll see spikes, big spikes. Because this is all rigged market. These prices are rigged. What about stock market? Give the money to Havala. Havala will then put it in your Swiss bank account. You take the money out of the Swiss bank account, go to Morgan Stanley or US Fidelity Investments, put the cash in the counter and say, give me a participatory note, here's my Indian passport. Why Indian passport? Because the only country in the world which has participatory note invented, and that is India. So therefore, only for Indians, those with Indian passports will get participatory notes issued. You look at and that participatory note doesn't put your name, nothing, only the amount. Take that, come to Mauritius, open a $1 company. In Mauritius, you can open a $1 company. I found in this 2G, all the 2G companies had Mauritius address. Then I looked closer, I found it was in the same street. Then I looked even closer, it was in the same building. Then when I looked closer, it was in the same floor. When I looked even closer, it was in the same room. And the room was locked. Whether it is Maxis or it is SR or it is Vodafone, all of them have the same room, that address. Why is it so important to have a Mauritius company, Mauritius base? Because if you make capital gains in the stock market, you and I have to pay 30%. But if you buy it by participatory notes, brought in by a Mauritius company or a Mauritius-based company, then you are forgiven. No capital gains tax. So they bring this participatory note, flood it into the market, the demand goes up for shares, it shoots up, sell, take the money, go back to the Reserve Bank, get it converted to dollars, go back. This is what has happened. Because earlier on when you deposited money in Switzerland, you had to pay 2% service charge. They didn't give you interest. Switzerland doesn't give you interest for a secret bank loan. So all the crooked politicians devised this. Then why should we pay 2% service charge? Let us see how to earn. And this is the device. And that's why the stock market is out of control. It's now called, universally called, the most rigged stock market in the world. So therefore, whether it's inflation, stock market, corruption is at the root of it. Then let's take our lopsided investment priorities. 70% of our investment directly or indirectly supports luxury goods production. In a country which has at least 25% below the poverty line, how can you justify this, that 70% is going in to produce luxury goods? That's because The black money is spent only on luxury goods. And if it's spent on luxury goods, the rate of profit of those industries go up. The rate of profits go up. Then why should anyone produce cloth and shoes and all common man's items? They will move their investment, which is usually 5 to 6 times the investment in essential goods sector. They go and invest it there to earn more profits, and the cycle goes on. And today it is 70%, very soon it will be 90%. So investment priority is lopsided. Artificial shortages are created thereby in essential commodities. National security, well, Hawala people have to go to Dubai and then telephone Switzerland. Their agent in Switzerland, that I've got so much cash in India, given to me by so-and-so, whose account number is so-and-so, whose password is so-and-so, so kindly deposit so much in millions of dollars. So he, and if somebody from there wants to come to India and wants rupees, I've got the rupees lying with me. So that's how this leveraging is done. Okay, that's fine, but then in Dubai you cannot do business unless you get an okay from ISI, because they control Dubai's financial center. Everybody knows that. So these Hawala fellows go and they do salam to ISI. ISI says, tell me which ministers, how much, which bank account. So ISI has the complete account of all our ministers' bank accounts in Switzerland or any other place, Isle of Man, Cayman Island, whatever. And they can blackmail you. All our ministers are scared. I would say all our politicians who have foreign bank accounts are scared of Pakistan. They are not able to do simple things against Pakistan. There's a terrorist attack. Everybody knows Pakistan has done it. We don't take any retaliatory measures. Very soon we start talking about cricket. And have their dancers and belly dancers and all come here and perform. And everybody forgets it. Till a new incident comes, then again 2 days of mourning and groaning. So, I can't think of any. Why are we getting substandard adulterated products? Corruption. Why don't we can't we build good roads? Corruption. So this is the problem that needs to be solved. It can be solved by a series of measures which are short run, which are medium term, and which are long run. And we have to understand what those are. The short run, of course, technology. Don't give any discretionary power. We used to have a huge amount of corruption in railway reservation tickets. You could not get a sleeper reserved unless you bribed the station master and the ticket collector and everybody else. Today, because of the computerization, is down to a minimum, even though there is cornering and things like that, but it's not a very serious problem. If you are able to download all the forms, you don't have to pay a bribe to the chapasi to go and wake up the boss so that he can sign. You get it on a download. So technology can do a lot of the short term. Medium term, you have to come to a situation where you catch people. Big people, not small people. Big people, and send them to jail. That happens in the United States of America. And that's why they control popular corruption to a very large extent. It's not that they catch everybody, but they catch a few and then throw the book at them. January 8, 2008, there were 2 press conferences at the same time. One in New York and another in Hyderabad. In New York, Bernard Madoff confessed to having defalcated on pension funds, created Ponzi schemes as they are called, and squandered billions of dollars. And he said, I confess, and I'm willing to accept any punishment. Hyderabad, Ramalinga Raju, also addressed a press conference, confessed to taking away 7,500 crores of company money, and confessed, said that he's ready for any punishment. Bernard Madoff, within 6 months, was sentenced to 150 years in jail, and he's in jail. And Ramalinga Raju, he's in an air-conditioned room, on a bail, I think. I don't think he's in jail. There you are. Jail is also air conditioned for him when he goes there. That is the way. That's the difference. That is why I concentrated on getting key politicians in the 2G. I'll get them, don't worry. I'm not going to let go anybody. Together in a company. Those of you who do not know much about this scandal, let me tell you, it is the make or break scandal. What is the scandal? National Herald was set up by congressmen and they unanimously elected Jawaharlal Nehru as his first chairman. 1937. 38, the publication started. Very popular because it was giving freedom news, news of the freedom struggle. 47, Jawaharlal Nehru became Prime Minister of Independent India. And National Herald started getting goodies, large plots of land, because it was a newspaper thing. They got in Delhi, in Bahadur Shah Zafar Marg, which is in a prime area. They got concessional, 1 rupee per acre rate. And they got donations to build a building. They built an 11-story building. And like that, they got properties in Bombay, in Madhya Pradesh, in UP, everywhere, Punjab, Haryana, all that. Still unraveling them. Now, what happens is that the National Herald paper, people say, now, who wants to read Congress news? So it started losing money. And finally, it was wound up in 2008. Closed down. At that time, the chairman was Motilal Vora, who also is the treasurer of the Congress Party. So after it wound up, over the years, they had got loans from the Congress Party, which all added up to 90 crores. So a new company was created in 2011.
So, in 2011, a new company is created. And this new company is called Young Indian Private Limited. I think it has 5 shareholders. Sonia, 38%. Rahul, 38%. Motilal Vora again, 12%. That means 76-88. And Oscar Fernandez, 12%, that makes it 100. And 2 hangers on, Suman Dube and Sam Pitroda. I don't know, Sam stands for Satyam or something like that. Now he's ashamed of being Satyam. So Sam Pitroda, 0 shares, but part of the board. Now, what is the significance of 76%? Professor Finance will tell you. Company is virtually yours. Extraordinary meeting, short-term meeting, 24 hours meeting, anything you can call. Minimum you need is 26%. Then the next would be 75%. Majority is fine, but really to control a company, you should have more than 75% and they have 76%. Anyway, the others are all tapastans, so it's not a problem. But now we find Motilal Vora in this year as a board member, as a treasurer of Congress Party, and as chairman of Associated Journals, which produces the National Herald, Homi Awas, and Jeevan, or used to produce. So a proposal comes from Sonia Gandhi that this 90 crores we will own up. We will say it is our liability. And all Congress Party write it off. It's a non-recoverable loan. There are some salaries to be paid. Here's 50 lakhs. And you sell all your shares to us. So the 100% shares of Associate Journal is sold to Young Indian. So Young Indian gets Badushah Zafar Mart, 11 story building. It also gets all the property around the country. Total, I have added all except to 5,000 crores. 5,000 crores for how much investment? 50 lakhs. This 50 lakhs seems to be a favorite because Butler also only gave 50 lakhs in return. But he only got 300 crores in return. These people got 5,000 crores. Brilliant. That building, then immediately Rahul Gandhi asked Mr. S.M. Krishna, open our office. So two floors are taken by the external ministry for passport seva kendra. That property was area was given for publishing a newspaper. But Mr. Rahul Gandhi has the cheek to tell the press that there's no question of our publishing a newspaper. This is only meant for improving the youth with our Rahul Gandhi's idea. So this is an outrageous corruption, it's multi-dimensional. First of all, no political party is entitled to give loans for commercial purposes. I sent it to the election commission saying they recognize the party, they said they have no power. But who's scared? It doesn't matter. So I have now to go to court. Then the second thing is that they got 13A, Section 13A Income Tax Act exemption on the grounds that this is political donation. I'm asking that we cancel then all taxes due for collection of these monies for the last 10 years should be levied on the Commerce Party. So I sent a notice to the Income Tax, that the Income Tax has said that we are referring it to the Director General of Intelligence. And we'll get back to you. And I'll give them 15 days more. Then I'll go to court. Third, Rahul Gandhi in 2008 owned 3 lakh shares in Associated Journals. In his 2009 election returns, like their nomination form, they have to file an affidavit. How many shares do you have in this company? And he's written nil. But I know of 2 companies where he had shares. One where he had 86% shares in a company called Backops. And the other was Associated Journals, 3 lakhs shares. He didn't declare it. This is a violation of election law, Revenue People Act, brought to the Election Commission. This time, they sent it to the District Magistrate of Amethi. Please hold it quiet. I'm waiting for the inquiry. So that is another matter. Then, of course, is breach of trust. The whole thing was given for this purpose, and you broke it. And in that breach of trust, you were a conspirator. Breach of trust, by the way, is a very severe criminal offense. So all this put together, I'm preparing a writ petition, which I'll file in January sometime, asking for an SIT to be set up into the affairs of the Gandhi family and prosecute them. They are really, people don't like my using the word Gangotri. Why are you defiling the name Gangotri? But the source of all corruption of the time we see today is this Sonia Gandhi family. He's looking for a riot, I think. He says, don't say Gangotri, say Makka. Anyway, so I want to tell you that these kinds of corruption you have to. The corruption in the medium term can only be cured and catch big people and send them to jail. In the process, you will discover more. Recently, what happened, if you have a few minutes, I'll just finish. 10 more minutes? Recently I discovered, because some Saeed Shahabuddin, old friend of mine, many people think I forced him to write to Modi. I did not. Nobody can force Shahabuddin to do anything. So he came to my house with some Muslims to say the matter I took up 25 years ago has not proceeded too far, and that is in a place called Meerut, in a mohalla called Hashimpura. On 22nd May 1987, a platoon of the PAC, Provincial Armed Constabulary, as a paramilitary force, entered that mohalla, brought out all the residents of the road, asked all the Hindus to go back home, then asked the old people to go back home, then asked all the women to go back home. The remaining youth, 42 of them, they put them on a truck, they then packed the truck, took the truck 20 kilometers away on the banks of a canal in Ghaziabad district. They made them get down one by one and shot them in cold blood at short range and kicked their bodies into the canal. Then that time it was brought to my attention, I went and saw, and I saw even then dead bodies blow. So I asked Mr. Rajiv Gandhi to hold an inquiry. He told me, don't get into it, it's a very complicated issue. But I went on a faster to death, to every kind I ever did and I ever will. Because if, unlike Kejriwal, I didn't get Ayurveda or whatever. So after the third day, fourth day, my life became miserable. On the seventh day, I think Rajiv Gandhi felt sorry for me. And then he ordered the inquiry. Inquiry proved what I said. And I forgot about it. But I remember raising it in Parliament, asking Mr. Chidambaram, who was then Minister of State for Home Affairs, what were you doing on the day before in Meerut, you know, Hashimpura? After much hot air, he finally confessed that he had gone there, but not for doing, carrying out this genocide. Then I forgot about it. This matter came up. I said, aha. So maybe another case is coming. So I went back to the Tihar, trial court where it's going on, and I put an allegation that the investigation is incomplete. Only the PAC has been held responsible. They had no motive. What is their motive? Somebody must have given them an order. Who gave them an order? So let's find out. So I have on the parliamentary record that Mr. Chidambaram was there, and therefore, he should be questioned. I also found out from one of the witnesses that Chidambaram was there the day after. Then I met a journalist who told me, you know what Chidambaram told me at that time? Like we shot these Sikhs, we have to shoot these Muslims to teach them a lesson. Because he wants to shoot everybody, he wants to shoot Hindus also. So he's a mental case. So now the application has been accepted. And 7th January is the argument. And imagine the man who's been chasing Hindu terror is himself a Hindu terror. Airfare Maxis, same thing. Because the shortage of time, I won't tell you the detail. But without him, Airfare could never have been sold to that LTT, pro-LTT, Sri Lankan Tamil owned Maxis, whose wife owns, by the way, shares in Dassault, big amount of shares in Dassault. Great friend of Sonia Gandhi because they believe in antique smuggling and they exchange notes very often. So they are a developing situation because we have to catch these big people to generate confidence that big people can be part. Finally, with that I conclude, long term, India was considered 1,000 years ago to be one of the most honest country. We have the word of Fasian coming from China, Yuan Chuang, Vasco da Gama, Mark Twain, so many visitors who said such honest people we have never seen anywhere. And that was because we had a system where money was not the indicator of social status. It was your sacrifice, it was your knowledge that we valued it most. This dawned on me in the most spectacular way when when I was a student at Harvard, my classmate asked me, how can you follow Mahatma Gandhi? And I said, why? Still the pilot doesn't even dress properly. And I said, what about your country? Do leaders have to dress? He said, yes, if they don't dress well, there's no chance. In fact, Nixon didn't shave for one debate with Kennedy, and he lost all that. So then I thought about it, the Pope, how decked he is, all our sadhus, the higher they go, the simpler they dress. So this has been our system. Money is not the decider of social things. We have, over this globalization, made money the driving force. For IIM Ahmedabad, ask the students, why you come here? They say, get a good job with a fat salary. Not that I've learned marketing or finance theory from Professor Vaidyanathan. I'm sure that IIM Bangalore is no better, also looking for a job. So that's a new concept that is coming. That will lead to corruption, because that will lead to greed. Greed means corruption. So the current affairs is signified by corruption, and we can remove it by three different levels of action: short term, medium term, long term. And therefore, our traditional values have to be given equal importance and brought back into focus. Then we will have a new India. Let me tell you, your opponents are not China. Because China's economy will collapse in the next 3 years. Somebody just brought a book of mine for autographing. You read it, I predicted this 5 years ago, that China is heading for a major financial blowout. Don't forget, Japan was considered as the next developed country in the world which will overtake America. As late as 1994, 1997, one crisis finished them, now they are in the dumps. Latin America, same thing, rose and crashed. China will also crash. You have, therefore, the whole world before you, and therefore we should prepare ourselves and ready for that. Thank you very much.
...5% per year. So, with the same change in policy, if we can bring it about, we can ensure a growth rate for at least the next 20 years of in excess of 12%. And it's not enough to be educated. You have to have a backbone. I mentioned this in all my speeches. It's not enough to have numbers. You can have 1,000 goats at one place, and one tiger comes, all the goats will run away. Majority is with the goats, and the tiger is a singleton. But the mental framework of the goat is fear, and he runs away. It's not enough to be strong, because you can go to a circus and see well-fed lions in a cage, and a thin, wiry ringmaster will walk in, close the gate, and then order the lions to climb up. We will build this movement and take it to an All India level. And it is from that point of view that we are organizing this conference. While tweeting, I find all of you have given me material which I couldn't get anywhere else. I just put out one tweet once saying, does anybody know how many companies Karthi Chidambaram owns? And within 3 days, I got a reply giving all the companies in which he was there. So yeah, it's a highly knowledgeable, educated crowd. And the country can progress enormously if the right policies are followed. We were told that the growth rate of India was the Hindu growth rate of 3.5%, where actually it was the communist rate of growth, because we were following the Soviet model. But we will never be able to grow faster than that. But one change in policy to economic reform made us go right up to 9. privilege to be here with him as in the chair. Much pleased to see all of you. You today may not realize it, but you represent a new social revolution in our country. It's the beginning of a social revolution. The empowerment of the educated class, which empowerment was systematically over the last 60 years denied. The empowerment of the educated class you can see in the United States, you can see it in Europe, you can see it in Japan, even in China. Even though it's a communist country, the people who wield the power are educated people. In India, we have lost that out after the freedom struggle had empowered the educated class. People sacrificed their careers, came into politics to fight for independence. And they were all eminent people. Over the years, it just slowly petered out. And today, we see a revival, thanks to this new media or the internet. And it's a value system which everybody, even today in India, subscribes to. And that is why people who have not passed fifth class claim that they were educated in the University of Cambridge. Because that's the what you want to be known as, an educated person. So I think they'll all climb up. He'll order them to open their mouth. He'll put his head inside. And these lions will not do anything when they can rip him apart into pieces. This is all because of the mindset. That's how the lion has been brought up from when it was a cub. And in lion, in Sanskrit, we call it Singh. So Manmohan Singh is a circus lion. It's no use giving him the Prime Minister's position. The only reason I want him to stay is because the one that's going to come after this is going to be worse. So therefore, let me begin by saying, today the whole idea of the conference is the mindset. What kind of a mind should you have to make India great once again? I've been out to speak on current affairs and politics. Politics is like fire.